Good morning. Good morning. I see you are all good Methodist and you fill in from the back. Are you afraid of me or something? I'll have to speak up a little bit. But no, it's great to see everybody. I told the early service it has felt like the distance between learning about the new appointment and actually arriving at the new appointment was a little longer this year. I've been so anxious and excited to come and be a part of Columbiana United Methodist. I have no clue what's going on in this church, so why they asked me to do announcements, I don't know. Although I do know there's VBS coming up. So if anybody sees someone coming who has anything to do with children, and you don't want to do anything with VBS, you need to run as fast as you can in the opposite direction. That being said, I will run after you, tackle you, and sign you up for something. So it will be best for you to go ahead and sign up for something that you think might be a little more up your alley. No, please, if you do have the ability to volunteer for VBS, we have a mass of children coming, and we will need to obviously keep them corralled in some way, shape, or form. Let us prepare our hearts and minds at this time as we turn to worship. I'm learning my cues. Let us pray. Gracious and almighty God, we thank you for the independence to be dependent upon you and one another. For if you have not made us as individuals, but people, each ourselves, to be united with one another and with you. We pray that we may use this freedom that you've given us to extend your word to this world. We pray that we might be your people so that everyone may come to know the true freedom that is only available through the love of Jesus Christ. We offer all this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Happy 4th of July. The year 1832 witnessed Samuel Smith, a 24-year-old theology student, agreeing strongly with the beliefs of William Penn, noted religious thinker and the founder of the province of Pennsylvania, who stated, and I quote, "Men must be governed by God, or they will be ruled by tyrants." Moved deeply by patriotism and the desire to create a national hymn that would allow the American people to offer praise to God for their wonderful land, Smith penned the words "To My Country, 'Tis of Thee" on a scrap piece of paper in less than 30 minutes. The emotionally powerful ideas expressed in the hymn, plus easily singable words coupled with the popular international melody, swiftly made it a national favorite. The stirring tributes to our fatherland in the first three stanzas led to a worshipful climax of gratitude in stanza four and a prayer for his continued guidance. Today, as we sing hymn number 697, may we remember that many wonderful, positive aspects of our great land and give praise to God for all his past blessings. Pray for his continued protection and guidance in future days, and carry this musical message as you go. My country, 'tis of thee. It's hymn number 697. Let us stand to sing.
Please remain standing and join with me as we affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended in heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This morning, let us prepare our hearts and minds as we approach the throne of grace in prayer and bow our heads together. Gracious and holy God, you have given us a wonderful gift, a gift we did not earn, a gift that we were simply given, honestly, by chance, that we were brought into this nation that affords us so many liberties, the ability to gather and to worship you, the ability to proclaim our faith without fear of reprisal. Lord, help us not to take these liberties for granted. But let us also remember that even though these liberties may not always exist, the freedom that you have given us to continue worshiping you and to continue praising your name will always endure. You have set us free from the fear of sin and death, from the fear of reprisals of the world, and from the fear that we may never be able to truly speak who we are. Instead, you have said we go forth into a world that needs to hear, even if it chooses not to. We ask, as we lift up to you all of these things, in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare for a time of offering, hear now the word of God through his prophet. And now on the first day of the week, bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. Do this, says the Lord of hosts, and see if I do not throw open the gates of heaven and pour out a blessing upon you that cannot be numbered. Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you for the gifts that you have blessed each of us with. We pray that we might have the courage and the strength to return what you have asked, what is yours already, so that it may be used to build your kingdom and that others may come to know your love through the word of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
have heard how Christians long ago were brought before a tyrant's throne. They were told that he would spare their lives if they would renounce the name of Christ. But one by one they chose to die. The Son of God they would not deny, like a great angelic choir sings. I can almost hear their voices ring.
I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength, with all I am. I will seek to honor His commands. I pledge allegiance to the
Now the years have come, and the years have gone, and the cause of Jesus still goes on. Now our time has come to count the cost, to reject this world, to embrace the cross, and one by one let us live our lives for the one who died to give us life, till the trumpet sounds on the final day. Let us proudly stand and boldly say,
I pledge allegiance to the Lamb with all my strength, with all
Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, O Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overflow, to build and to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. The word of God for the people of God.
Once again, good morning. One of the joys of being a pastor that they did not tell me about was that we get invited into some pretty intimate parts of people's stories. You know, our story is always meant to be something that gives us an identity. We have family stories, you know, the ones you tell jokingly over family dinners at holidays. And then we have just those memories that turn into stories over time that have fed into our identity. Well, as a pastor, I get to enter into those stories with you. Now, some of them are just communicated, and I can't wait to hear all of your stories about where you're from, how'd you get here, and what brought you to the place that you are, what made you you. Those are all great stories to have. And then sometimes, at some point, not only will I hear your stories, but I will enter into your stories. I may sit in a room with you as we say goodbye to a loved one. I may baptize one of your children or your grandchildren. I may marry off your daughter with that idiot she's been dating for however long. These are all very intimate parts of people's stories. And as a pastor, it's amazing that I just get to walk in and be a part of it and be welcome in that. I do not take that lightly. And so, as we begin this time together, and as I know over the months and years ahead, I will get to know your stories about how you are you and what makes you you, I wish to share with you this morning some of my story. I share with you my story not because of who I am, but because of what God has done in and through this life. In fact, we are all united by a greater story, a story that is meant to override all of ours, one that our individual stories will acquiesce to, will bow down to. That's the story of God throughout Scripture, breaking into human history, at times miraculously. And Jesus has given us this story to define ourselves, to tell us who we are. My story starts out pretty idyllic. I grew up in Mount Pleasant, North Carolina. It sounds as cute as you think it does. We had a drugstore that was opened in 1822 that was still being run by the same family of pharmacists that opened it. This drugstore had a soda fountain, a working soda fountain. I worked at that soda fountain. I am probably the only person, I might be the youngest person on the planet that knows how to make a soda. When's the last time you had a real made soda? I'm not talking about the, no, that's not how you make soda. It was great at home, too. I'm the youngest of three. That'll tell you a lot. I'm also the only boy. That will also tell you a lot. And my two older sisters tormented me until I was big enough to defend myself. And then it was great. We had a really great life. My dad was in textiles. He was kind of in a middle management position in actually textile testing supplies and materials. It took him all over the world for quite a while, and it was very interesting because we would get phone calls at home at all hours of the day because someone would be calling from China or from the Middle East. Or one time I remember picking up the phone and someone saying it was the Smithsonian. That was an interesting one. But it was also interesting when later on I went to school in DC and I got to go to the National Archives and see Old Glory. The flag that waved over Fort McKinley as Francis Scott Key wrote his song. My father's machinery and his laboratory equipment helped restore it. It was a very interesting life. Mom was a teacher. She was great. She always had the youngest of the kids, and for some reason they gave her the worst ones, which prepared her pretty well for us three kids at home. So things were going well. But then textiles, not everybody bought American. Really, we can't blame it on that. It's just a simple shift in the world's economy, and my father lost his job for the first time. I was around 12, and so he started trying to find jobs that anything he could to help the family make ends meet. And then when he couldn't do that alone anymore, Mom took an additional job. By this time, my sisters, we have a pretty far spread between us, my sisters were old enough to be out of the house. One was at college and one was starting her life. And I suddenly was in a large home all alone. Mom's second job didn't let her get home until 9 or 10 at night, and obviously, having worked since 7 o'clock that morning, she was exhausted. To a 12-year-old, this was a little jarring, because all of a sudden, everything was gone. The sense of security that I had, even though I didn't understand that's what it was at the time, that sense of security had disappeared because now my family was financially struggling. My parents, who had been stalwarts in my life, had been at all of my soccer and baseball and every other stinking thing I drug them to. They were there all over the place. They're gone now. I mean, I saw Dad once every 6 weeks as he would come back from a job in New York State. But this was after having Dad been regularly present. Now, I will say, throughout this life, the church has been a constant. Everything happened in my church. Everything in the community. We lived out in the country, and it was a great church, extremely active, pretty large, actually, for a country church. Had about 300 or so people in it, and everything happened there. My baseball team practiced on the church ball field. I went to Cub Scouts in the basement and Boy Scouts in the Boy Scout hut out back. I learned to cook proper barbecue, which you people do not do. sorry, but y'all have got it wrong. I will cook you proper barbecue at some point, but I learned how to cook proper barbecue at this place. I mean, that was after years of being there. You're not allowed to get anywhere near the barbecue pit until you've put your time in, you see. Everything happened at church, and it was active, and they were great. I would come home knowing I was going to have to fend for myself as a 12, 13, 14-year-old. and there would be a cooler on the front porch with a casserole in it. We Methodists know how to show love through food. Jesus' grace in the form of a casserole. We got to a place where we could no longer afford to live in the beautiful farmhouse that I had grown up in. And my parents decided that it was time to sell, but we were not going to be able to sell it because they weren't able to keep up with the maintenance. There was much that needed to be done, many appliances that needed to be replaced, and needed a fresh coat of paint, and we just didn't have the money. And then one Saturday morning, we woke up to the doorbell at 8 a.m. I'm sure Dad had a few choice words, thinking it was the Baptist from down the street coming by to save our souls again. Instead, when we opened the door, there were about 75 people from Mom and Dad's Sunday school class. Several of the general contractors of the church were there with their crews. They had been quietly raising money and gathering materials to completely fix up our house so that we could sell it, knowing that we would be moving away from them. During all of this, God thought that at the perfect time when I was completely taken apart, when my life was thrown completely up in the air, when honestly, if we were to be very honest with it, my family was not dealing well with it. You throw this much stress into a family, you're going to have some dysfunction. Good news, we're all better now. Relatively. But during all of this, God decided that this was the best time to let me know that He wanted me to be one of His servants. Well, I did what any smart 14-year-old would do. Rejected that thing completely. And decided that since I had learned very well in church exactly what a good Christian boy should do, if I did the exact opposite, God would not want me to be a part of His army. And that's what I started doing. I started doing everything to get into trouble. As I was growing up and growing, trying to start my own life after graduation, I thought that the best way for me to get away and to just live my life on my terms was to move out at 18 and try to live on my own. Kids, if you ever think you can live on your own at 18 years old, you're wrong. I had a small junky apartment in Raleigh, North Carolina, and I got into as much unsavory action as I possibly could. I chased after everything. I was chasing after girls. I was chasing after various chemicals, anything to take my mind away from or to numb myself from the constant nagging of the Holy Spirit in my mind. I wanted nothing to do with God because I felt that God had taken everything I loved away from me. My father was gone through a very formative time in my life. My mother was gone through a very formative time in my life. I wanted nothing to do with this. Now, I will say some good things came out of this time. One, because I was 12 years old and suddenly home alone quite a bit, I became quite independent. If You ask my wife, that may not be a positive, but I've become pretty independent. She is happy that I do know how to fold laundry and iron and cook. She's not happy that I'm stubborn and dogged and pretty aggravating at times. One Christmas, I was in my apartment, and there wasn't enough money in my bank account to put gas in my car to go home. It was only a 2-hour ride, so that's how little money there was. I would be celebrating Christmas at home, though celebrating is really being kind of generous. There wasn't a whole lot of food. Obviously, I was not going to put up any lights or anything. I couldn't afford extra higher electricity bills. And then I received a phone call from a friend. The one good influence in my life at this time. The only one who really was a friend. Everyone else was acquaintances that, you know, when you're living the way that I was living, you don't look out for one another. But this friend called me. He invited me to go to Christmas Eve worship at his church, and well, I wanted nothing to do with that, so I said, no, I'm not going to do that. And he said, well, do you mind if I come over afterwards? I was like, yeah, sure. So he comes over to my apartment. I am bundled up in probably about 3 layers of everything so that I can keep the heat down. And he comes in with a bag of presents. And he's like, I want you to have these. So I start going through the bag, and it's things like food, toiletries, cleaning supplies, stuff that I needed, stuff that would help me out. To this day, it's probably the most meaningful Christmas present I've ever received. And then at the bottom of the bag, there was a small present. And he said, wait for that tomorrow so you can have something to open on Christmas. And we spent some time together, and he went back home. And then, like any good person with lots of self-control, I immediately ran to the bag and opened the present. Because let's face it, you would open them all your presents on Christmas Eve, too, if it weren't for the kids. I opened the present, and inside was a small box. This box. And I opened it up, and my friend was worked at the Natural History Museum in Raleigh. This is not going to cause a lot of feedback if I go out here, is it? And he got me a fish. It's a fossilized fish. It's no bigger than a minnow. Some little fish from the Cretaceous period. Any scientists in here? I have no idea how long ago that was. And I thought that was pretty cool, you know, because all the rest of the stuff was very practical and it was useful. And this was just something nice that he gave me that, you know, obviously he just picked up in the gift shop at his museum. And so I thought that was pretty neat, and I put the lid back on and I went up to bed. And then I came back down the next morning, knowing that I had enough food to have a Christmas meal. And I sat down and I opened this present again and I just looked over the small fish, and it's got a little sticker on the back that says it's from Brazil. It's got a little card inside that gives you the information on it. and then I turn the card over. On the back, my friend had written something. It comes from Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you a fisher of men." I was almost positive I had ruined my reputation enough with God to get out of this. I tried my best. There he was. And over time, he began to open my eyes to how, even though I felt at the time everything had been taken away from me, instead, he was showing me that everything was still there. It was just in another form. You see, I didn't have to take care of myself because there was a casserole on the front porch. Yes, my mother and father were gone quite often, but then there were the men and the women in our church who stepped up into that role and would invite me over to their homes for dinner, would take me out fishing and hunting with them, would make sure I was okay. There were 75 people standing in our front yard, willing to let us go after almost 20 years because they knew it would be better for us in the long run. There was the church every step of the way. Even when I ran, he was right there. And there was nothing I could do. At that moment, I recognized that God had won, as he typically does, and I was going to have to change a few things, that I was going to have to follow. I'd always grown up in the church, I'd always believed in God, but now something was different. Now, I wish I could say that from that point on, everything was gravy, but it was not. Trying to make my way through undergrad without my parents' ability to help financially, and then trying to get up into grad school so I could get the degree necessary to become a Methodist pastor, it was, frankly, constant stress on how I could pay for things. But he provided each step of the way. I wish he would have done it a little farther ahead of the way, but no, he still did it. And he took some kid out of a hayfield in North Carolina. And in the first generation of our family who went to college, he took him through a terminal degree, by the way, is aptly named. Now, I wish I could say this was anything of me, but it was not. There is no reason for me to stand in front of you. You're going to hear in my sermons that I am typically the bad example rather than the good one. I am hardly ever the hero in my story. Amy's usually the hero, as a matter of fact, because she is so much better a person than I. But I've discovered that in sharing my failures and in sharing Jesus' grace, others have become more comfortable in their own faith, knowing that we do not have to have it all together, knowing that when God has made up his mind about you, that's it. We are each given a a divinely granted purpose in our life. Sometimes it coincides with our job, sometimes it doesn't. But every single individual one of us has a unique purpose for being here. And when we tap into God's purpose for our lives, there is nothing that He cannot do through us. I say that from experience. I say that because I should not be standing in front of you. And yet, He has brought me here. I cannot wait to hear your stories. I cannot wait to hear how God has transformed your life. I can't wait to hear about some of your failures, because those tend to be fun stories, especially when we talk about how God takes it, twists it around, and somehow turns what you thought was a failure into something glorified and amazing. Thank you for allowing me, welcoming me to be your pastor. Please join with me on number 12 in your hymnals as we hear the invitation of our Lord to His holy table. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Holy God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Jesus Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. May the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Spirit upon all of us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite the servers forward. I will serve them, and they shall serve me, and then I will give you a few further instructions. the Church of Jesus Christ, the table of the Lord is open to all who wish to experience the grace that is promised to occur and be poured out upon us each and every time we shall receive it. Come now, the table has been set, the grace is abundant and free. And now, if you will, please stand and join with me on number 172 in your hymnals as we lift our voices and sing, My Jesus, I Love Thee. And now, as you go forth from this place, receive this blessing upon your lives. May the power of Almighty God keep you safe from all harm. May the glory that is our risen Savior shine through you for all this world to see. And may in every house my Christ be your guest. Amen.